You've got two singers in this band, so right off the bat, that has to be taken into consideration. Let's pop this baby open, see what's happening. Again, you can see I cut them up based on musical position. Vocals in the verses are on their own track, so I can really dial in that sound. Here's my vocal bus. Since Pro Tools 2020 came along, I've been using their new folder system, so I can quickly just do that and get rid of everything. And now I'm just looking at the instrument families on the top level, and I can pop this open, see what's underneath. You can pretty much see that I've got a vocal chain here that I am repeating for most of the vocal tracks. I might come up with a chain in the chorus, because that's usually the loudest sung part in the song, and then I will save that chain, apply it to all the tracks, and then when I get to those sections, I will evaluate the settings and see if I want more compression, less compression, brighter, darker, whatever it is. So what's happening? We're trying to emphasize aggression, intensity. You know, the first thing you start thinking of is a lot of compression and probably some distortion. But before you reach the distortion stage, or at least for me, I like to do a little bit of control.
Went back into the dark!
That's the raw track.
So where were you when I fell out?
So I'm controlling a little bit of those high mids on the higher notes, the screams. I don't want it to thin out. I want it to stay full bodied. I'm doing some de-essing and kind of mitigating the high mids. Moving on to gain reduction, my favorite vocal compressor.
So where were you when I fell out? Went back into the dark. I'm lost.
All right, just brings it right up to your forehead in terms of presence. Fab filter de-esser. Talked about de-essers on Crow's Eye a lot. On this song, I wanted to get a little more surgical. I probably have a couple layers of de-essing. I have one on the tracks, and I've got one in the bus that I can see here. But on the tracks, I wanted something a little more surgical, a little bit more control. And this one from Fab filter is awesome.
So where were you when I fell out? Went back into the dark.
What? I'm only compressing the highs. I am not doing a wideband compression. I do have the look ahead up, 12 milliseconds. This plugin is having plenty of time to analyze the upcoming S that it's going to gain reduce. This is heavy duty modern mixing right here. With look ahead, it requires digital. It allows the algorithm to be much more accurate in terms of what it's catching and what it's letting through. And then we have Sound Toys. Gonna add one more layer of intensity. The Devil Lock. Great distortion plugin. I use it all the time on tons of different things. And I just want to add another layer of distortion, another layer of saturation.
Let's get this shine! I'm fine without you! I'm not your prey! So save your...
Kind of doing all this mitigating the high end and de-essing so that I can distort it later in the chain. But now we've gotten a little too spitty again, so we're gonna go to my go-to saturator, tape saturator, Phoenix. Love this thing, use it on so many tracks. This is set up to darken the vocal.
Let's get this shine! I'm fine without you! I'm not your prey! So sad! Yourself and no one else. Let's get this shine. I'm fine without you.
Pretty subtle, but it's rounding off those toppy spikes. Before we get to the rest of the vocal tracks, I just want to cover the bus real quick here. Nothing really going on my virtual mix bus. Oh, here we go. So we've got three de-essers really happening. We've got one on the track, two on the bus, another Fab filter, wide band catching some S's on the vocal bus.
Went back into the dark!
Not very much. I'm imagining it's probably going to be picking up a few more in the chorus, which is a little louder. And then we've got this other de-esser.
So where were you when I fell out? Went back into the dark!
Grabbing a few. C4 on the bus.
So
it's it's not working too hard. It's just going to grab a few things here and there. The MAG EQ, not the MAG EQ, M-A-A-G. I'm just adding a half dB of boost at 650, I think. 2.5K, and on their air band, which is set at 20K, 1 dB of lift there. And then a Phoenix set to radiant, neutral, and 38 on the process. In these verses, the vocals are fairly constant, not a whole lot of space between the phrases and the syllables. A little bit of a losing battle to have a longer echo or reverb, because in order to really hear it, you kind of have to have some space in between the lines to appreciate it. For this section, I chose a very short ambience, calling that send vocal room is the Ocean Way Studios plugin, and I've got it set to vocal group. Studio A, vocal group. I've got the high pass engaged on all three sets of microphones, and it looks like I've kept it pretty much stock configuration. I mean, I've selected the studio and the source. There's some low cutting happening on the EQ.
So where were you when I fell out, went back into the dark? I'm lost. Let's get this shine. What fine without you? Let's get this shine. What fine without you?
You could use a slap, do something similar, but I actually think the room is a little more effective here in being sly about the fact that there's even an effect happening. So that brings us into the chorus. We have the same chain, but it looks like I left the room out again. And again, no effects on the double and no distortion and no Phoenix either. Although Phoenix on the double and the chorus. Here's the chorus vocal with no effects.
You got the best of me.
So much more legato, tends to sound good with a little bit of pitch shift.
Got the best of me.
Spreads it out stereo-wise a little bit. Because he's doing these long notes, I'm introducing a plate reverb here in the chorus.
You got the best of me.
Giving him some extension. And then I'm also adding a quarter note delay.
You got the best of me. Why taste you on my day?
And with the double.
You got the best of me.
This is the first time that Aaron is going to jump into the song. He has a vocal part that layers over Spencer's chorus vocal.
You got the best of me.
I guess you would call these answer lines. Got the same chain, probably some, you know, slightly different settings here to suit his voice. The bigger thing is that I'm panning, and I'm also treating Aaron's voice, his lead and his dub equally. So they're both at the same level, minus 11.3, but they're panned 40 left and 40 right. Just trying to separate him a little bit from the lead. The leads are up front and in the center. I'm panning him out, giving him even a little bit more sauce. Chorus two, and then we go into the bridge. In my initial mix of this song, I made this bridge vocal moment. I featured it. I made it more like the vocals in the chorus, and I got shut down because that wasn't the intent. And I just didn't know that. Maybe I didn't pay attention to the rough mix there, or maybe I did and just decided, well, I'm going to present a different way of dealing with this bridge vocal and see what the band thinks. And they didn't like it. It was too loud. They wanted it to be much more background and more mysterious. Pretty sure I brought it down too low. Yeah, but now we can't hear the lyrics, so we ended up in this place right here where you can make out the lyrics. It sounds like the whole band actually, like, in a, you know, tunnel or something. I'm doing that with a bunch of room and a bunch of plate. A lot of plate on these two guys down here.
One day you might be hungry.
One day you might be hungry.
So we've got the low.
You might be hungry.
And then we've got the higher.
One day you might be hungry. One day you might be hungry.
So that is the vocals. That gets you through drum kit, percussion, bass guitar, guitars, keyboards, vocals. In this last section, I'm just going to talk about the stereo bus. Definitely talked about stereo bus processing quite a bit in the past. I think it'll be worth it to look at it on this song in particular because there's a lot of it. I only have one plugin slot that's not being used. Truth be told, this little EQ at the end here, all I'm using that for is to lower the volume of the mix here because I'm recording this for YouTube. All I'm doing is just dropping the volume by 12 dB so that I can hear myself talking when I'm recording the Pro Tools output for these videos. So forget about that, but we'll have to leave it on. And then we can forget about this, which is just my stereo meter. Uline loudness meter too. This is the basic form of it and it's free. So really what we have is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have 7 plugins. I've showed this before in other videos. It's called the virtual mix bus. It adds a little bit of harmonic information as if you were running through an actual analog console. You've got these different flavors you can click through. And I typically have something like this as the first plugin in my stereo bus. Probably not working too hard. I've only got like 3 dB of drive going into it. It's really easy to overload the stereo bus as you're working. I've had to trim these back as I've been working to keep everything downstream not distorting and not clipping. Then we've got a SSL style bus compressor. This is the IK Multimedia bus compressor. Love this one. I love the interface. I've got a ratio of 4:1. I've got a slow attack of 10 milliseconds. So the drum transients are getting through before the compression is clamping them down. That's giving us some extra attack on the drums. I've also got a fast release also helping the drums and just creating some excitement overall as the mix is pumping a little bit. I've got the sidechain high pass filter. I have this clicked up to 60 to let that 808 not trigger the compression too hard. My threshold at 8.2 dB. This is actually kind of cool because when you bypass it, it's not that big of a change, but you can hear the subtlety of what it's doing to the drums. If you listen carefully, you will hear the attack of the kick and snare get a little louder when I take it out of bypass. Really subtle, mostly on the kick. Then I've got what I like to call a no-C EQ, no visual feedback. And you just have to use your ears here and twiddle the knobs. Just doing a very subtle half dB high-end boost, low-end boost, a mid-range boost around 3.4K of a half dB, and 11K boost of a half dB. Pretty subtle. I really like what's happening to the guitars with this EQ and maybe the drums too. Again, fairly subtle. So this is kind of following like a traditional path, right? That you would have at a mixing studio with the console and everything. You'd have the console itself, the VMR, adding a little bit of mojo to your mix. Stereo bus compressor, if it's an SSL console, this would be built right into the console. Then you might hit a stereo bus EQ on your way to tape machine. Everything after the tape machine is sort of like this faux mastering thing. But let's just look at the tape machine right now and see what's happening. This is a great plugin. I kind of have my go-to settings here. 30 ips, FG9, half inch tape, as opposed to an individual 2-inch 16 track. Sometimes I'll use that on a drum bus. Normal bias, you can take the noise down. You can add a little bit of wow and flutter, which I think is cool and adds like a cool subtle stereo thing to your whole mix. And then I'm lowering the bass alignment by 3/4 of a dB because I just think that the default sort of tone setting for this plugin is bass heavy. If you really need a lot more bass, then that's cool. I usually end up lopping off anywhere from half dB to a full dB of this bass alignment setting. The low end just blossoms out into this really fat awesomeness. There's a little bit more stereo at play because I have that wow and flutter turned up. There's some high mids and high end that's being mitigated or controlled just a little bit. Not worlds away, but to me it's cool what it's doing. I often have a tape plugin in this position, usually after a compressor and an EQ. And then we're going into post-tape machine processing. And the first thing I have is a FabFilter Pro Q2. So this was right before, I guess, I updated to the Pro Q3. They're both great. I'm doing some really subtle adjustments here. A couple dips, a little 500 dip, a little 80 dip, and then a little boost of the real lows, shelving EQ down here, and then a shelving high-end EQ. So let's hear what the difference is with and without that. Here's without it. My Q is very wide. I don't want to hear anything notched or phasey. Subtle shifting here. Tame down some of the mud in the low areas and just a little bit of high shelf to kind of bring a little sparkle back into the mix post this darkening tape. Then we go into the two other plugins, which are level maximizing plugins. So this one is really kind of a unique one, I think. It's been around for quite a while. It's the Slate FGX Virtual Mastering Console. Doesn't have an EQ in it, so I don't know how it would be in full console, but it's pretty cool. It has basically like an analog compressor, hardly ever used because I've already compressed this thing earlier in the chain here. What I am using is their level control. What this section is kind of unique at is it really focuses on the dynamics and the transient information. So you've got sort of a low punch on the transients and then just overall level of transients or detail. And then you've got the amount of the process. And then this guy too, dynamic perception. So what is happening here? Loudness maximizer, that's what it is. But I like that it has these controls here because often what happens when you're adding that kind of limiting is you lose transient detail. So this allows you to put some of that back. So the next one is this plugin, Elevate by Newfangled Audio, which is somehow a part of Eventide, I think. This is a full-on mastering plugin. It does have EQ. Once the band has signed off, this last level maximizing plugin in my stereo bus chain, whatever it is, I bypass it before I print the final pre-master files to send to mastering so that they have some headroom to work with analog, digital, whatever they're gonna do. I mean, it's 3 dB louder. That's essentially what's happening. There's not a whole lot of character difference. There's not a whole lot of tonality shift. It's just louder. I feel good about bypassing this before I deliver those pre-masters. I think I've covered a lot of ground here. on this song. This band was super cool to work with, so I'd like to thank them for having me. I'd like to thank them for letting me do this on my channel. I hope you got your fill of hard rock mixing in this episode. Thanks for watching. I will see you in the next video.
Later.